Okay, let's talk about the Praxis Algebra 1 exam. So if you're watching this video, I assume you're preparing to take the Praxis Algebra 1 exam, which obviously means that you are interested in teaching Algebra 1, and the Praxis exam is the exam you have to take in certain states to be certified to teach Algebra 1. Algebra 1 is a very, very critical math course, okay? You can be taken at the middle school or high school level, but I would have to say that it's probably one of the most important, if not the most important. If I had to choose, is there like one singular most important math course from middle and high school math? I think for me personally, through my experience, Algebra 1 could very well be it. So what we have here is a practice problem that you should find really easy if you're fully prepared for the Praxis Algebra 1 exam. So we'll get to that problem here in a second, but let me go ahead and introduce myself. My name is John. I'm the founder of Tablet Class Math. I'm also a middle and high school math teacher, and over the last several years, I've constructed many online math classes to include a Praxis Algebra 1 test prep course. I'm going to leave a link to that in the description of this video, but Algebra 1 is a course that I've taught for several years, and I've taught other courses obviously as well, and I think that's why by just, you know, teaching at the both middle school level and high school level, if you are new to teaching, and I might just assume that you're an experienced teacher already, but if you are new to teaching, that Algebra 1 class is really kind of the bridge from middle school math to high school math. And it's just been my observation that those students that do really, really well in Algebra 1 tend to do pretty good, if not really well, in high school math. But those students that struggle in Algebra 1, you know, they are going to have a tough time in high school level math. It's just been my general observation. But you know, the students, when they take Algebra 1, are going to be at that, you know, younger age, you know, 8th grade or 9th grade. So your ability to teach this class and these concepts to, you know, younger students, while they may not be taking it as serious as you are, your teaching ability and your command of the knowledge of Algebra 1. There's a lot of information, by the way, in Algebra 1. Everyone's like, oh, it's just Algebra 1. No, there's a lot of information that's coming that's in that curriculum. You know, if you're teaching a real comprehensive Algebra 1 class, you got to know your stuff. And obviously, you are, you know, building your skill sets up by virtue of you watching this video. So let's go ahead and get to this practice problem here. Okay, so let me just tell you what the problem is. Then I'm going to give you a little bit of a hint, and then I'm going to solve the problem. Okay, so I'd like you to find the equation of a line that passes through this point and has this slope. And I'd like you to put that equation in slope-intercept form. Okay, slope-intercept form. So find the equation of a line in slope-intercept form, okay, that has a slope of negative one-third and passes through the coordinate 2, 5. All right, so for those of you out there that can do this problem, I suspect most of you can be like, oh yeah, I can handle this problem, because you're obviously focused in on Algebra 1. Go ahead and pause the video. Go ahead and do it in your own way, because there's different approaches to this problem. And then if you need a bit of a hint, I'm going to give you a hint right now. So if you don't want to hear the hint, pause the video. Okay, so what is slope-intercept form? All right, so slope-intercept form is that y equals mx plus b. It's the most common way we like to write linear equations. There are other forms, but the slope-intercept form is just it's a really good form to write lines, because here this y equals mx plus b, the m is the slope or this coefficient in front of this x, and then the b here is what? It's the intercept, but it's specifically the y-intercept of a line. So there's a couple different ways you can approach this. You can actually use this equation to find the full equation of the line. Okay, but there's another way as well. You can use a slope, the point slope equation, which I really like. It's y minus y1 equals m times x minus x1. So I would prefer to find the equation of lines using the point slope formula, but you can also use the slope intercept equation or formula as well. But here's the main kind of concept, overarching principle, is in order to find the equation of any line in algebra, okay, or in mathematics, you need two pieces of information. You need two pieces of info, okay? So what do you need? Well, you're going to need the slope, and you're going to need one point that's on the line, okay? So why is this important? Well, you're going to get a variety of problems that could be like, hey, find the equation of a line that goes to the point 2, 5 and let's say negative 1, 7. So in this case, you have two points. That's not enough information. It is enough information, but not in its current form. So what you have to do is what? You have to find the slope between these two points. Once you have the slope, you can either use this point or this point along with that slope. You're still going to come up with the same answer if you do things properly, okay? But learning your equations, how to graph lines, how to find the equation of lines are just an absolute core skill of Algebra 1, okay? Extremely important, and you're going to spend a considerable amount of time teaching your students this stuff. If I recall correctly, when I was teaching Algebra 1, it all depends on what your curriculum is, your pacing, etc. But I would spend, this would be like a couple chapters worth of stuff, maybe like a full month, possibly, if I recall right. And I could be off a little bit here and there, but, you know, just think about all the things you have to teach your students. You have to teach them how to find the slope, what the slope is, have, you know, just a conceptual idea, you know, of how to apply the slope in real life. Then you got to go through all the mechanics of how to graph lines, etc. But when you get to this point, this is how to find the equation of lines. And now this is a whole different ball of wax. Okay, so those are your hints. Kind of went off a little bit on a tangent, but it's obviously all related to a problem like this, which is, you know, represents a lot in algebra. Okay, so let's go ahead and get right to it. I'm going to go ahead and solve this now. I'm going to use one of my favorite formulas. I really like this point slope formula. It's nice and easy to use. So let's go and do it now. So it's going to be y minus y1 is going to be this y coordinate there, right? So that's 5. And I'm not going to be fully explaining this because, you know, I don't want to make this video any longer than it is. So here's my other plug-in value. My m is, of course, negative 1/3 times x minus this x1 is my other plug-in value, which will be this x coordinate, right? So I got xy here, so that'd be 2. All right, so now I'm going to go ahead and just double check here, make sure I didn't make any mistakes plugging things in. Everything looks pretty good. So what am I going to do? All right, well, I'm going to start cleaning this up and getting it into y equals mx plus b form. So I'm going to apply the distributive property right here. So that'd be y minus 5 equals negative 1/3 x plus, right? Negative times a negative. So that's negative 1/3 times 2. If you need to kind of go over here just to be, you know, real clear on what's going on, that's fine. Okay, just don't make any errors. That's the whole plan. That's going to be positive 2/3, right? So that'd be positive 2/3. And then what do I do here to finish this problem up? I got to add 5 to both sides of the equation. And I can have this as y is equal to negative 1/3 x plus 2/3 plus a 5 is going to be 5 2/3. I'll just leave that as a mixed fraction like so. And there you go. Okay, so that is my answer. Of course, I assume, I hope, cross my fingers, I didn't make any errors. I don't think I have. But anyway, so that is a solution. Now, if you used this formula, the slope-intercept formula, that's fine, okay? You could have used that. But again, you're going to have to know both techniques, all right? Sometimes it definitely makes sense to use the slope-intercept formula. Now, let's just talk about this real quick. Why would I want to use the slope-intercept formula directly? What if I gave you this point instead of 2, 5? Let's say I give you the point 0, 7, okay? Well, you would want to give this to your students, a problem like this, because 0, 7, right? Let's just draw this on a number line real quick. x and y, the coordinate 0, 7 is going to be like up here, right? X is 0 and y is 7. So this is representing the y-intercept. This would be your b right here, this 7, okay? So this is a kind of a nice little problem to give. You don't want your students to take this information and plug it into the point-slope formula, you know. So again, that's why you need to know both, and you really need to be in command of, you know, all these Algebra 1 concepts, all right? And like anything, it's not good enough, in my opinion, for you just to be strong in Algebra 1 to be an Algebra 1 teacher. If you really look at the standards, you know, the certifications, especially at the high school level mathematics, you know, I have a degree in math, I have a master's degree as well, but, you know, you need to have a much higher level of mathematical, you know, knowledge, you know, if you will, to be teaching the level, you know, the levels underneath you, okay? So, you know, Algebra 1, you really get into a lot of concepts that are, you know, going to set up how students are going to understand more advanced mathematics, you know, functions, systems, you know, polynomials, etc. So it's important that you understand how this is going to impact them understanding more advanced material. So that's why you need to understand more advanced math, if you will. Okay, so enough of all this great advice. Of course, I can go on and on because I just love math that much. Let's go and wrap up this video. Again, I'm going to leave a link to my Praxis Algebra 1 test prep course in the description of this video if you want to check that out. If you're new to my YouTube channel, I've been on YouTube for a good 12 years or so at the time of this video. I already have hundreds of videos on my channel if you like my teaching style that can help you out. But hopefully consider subscribing as I'm posting new stuff all the time. If you liked the video, definitely appreciate a thumbs up and leave me some feedback. You know, what's drawn you to take this particular exam? You know, have you been teaching another subject? Are you coming right out of college, you know, into teaching? Or maybe you're making a career change. I will say this much, and I always like to stress this, and I do a lot of teaching certification videos, but I always like to say this much. Even if you are like, you know, got a PhD in math and you're like just super awesome and all, and I'm sure most of you out there are that, you know, at that level right now. And if you're not, you will get to that point, you know, and learn all the math and everything else. But that, you know, remember, you're going to become a teacher. And the big deal here is you're going to be dealing with, it's not just about learning math. It's about communicating math to people who've never understood or never seen these topics before. And that is the art of teaching. And that's, you know, where you have to, you know, develop experience and skills, many of which they, you know, you can learn in a book in terms of what they are. But you, it's just like being a pilot, an aircraft pilot. I like to use this example. You know, yeah, you can, you know, watch all the videos and study all the books to learn how to fly an airplane. But until you actually flow an airplane 10,000 hours, that's when you become a professional. So give yourself time. Latch on to those veteran teachers that can help you and guide you, you know, to manage all those other parts of what it means to become a teacher. It's, you know, I don't care who you are or what background you have. If you've never dealt with kids in a classroom, you know, it can be humbling. So, you know, don't give up, number one. Two, you know, give yourself time to develop experience because teaching is definitely a rewarding career, okay? All right, so with that being said, I definitely wish you all the best on this Praxis Algebra 1 exam. Thank you for your time, and have a great day.